Peter denied Jesus 3 times without even knowing. He even forgot that Jesus warned him just earlier. That's how serious the pressure was. That he forgot. It was not long ago Jesus told him that this will happen. Somebody will think, man, you were warned. But under serious pressure, the mind can easily go blank. And he forgot that he was warned. So he denied Christ 3 times. From that moment onward, it's been persecution upon persecution of the church. But then the Holy Spirit was eager. The Holy Spirit could not wait to come down. Open your Bible to the book of Acts. Being away the past couple of months has been really, really good. It's been a blessing to me. And especially going with my wife, you know, to Germany to minister was a great thing. Because sometimes the people at home can easily make you lose confidence in yourself and what you have and what you carry. You have to watch the people at home, people that you're close to, people who are in your house, your family members, people who know you inside out. You have to be careful because they will make you lose confidence in what you have and who you are and what you can do. They'll make you forget what you carry, trivializing you. Yeah, or they will be blessed by you so much that, you know, it's so common. So people at home can make you lose confidence, can easily make you become a timid person. Tell your neighbor, I refuse. Oh, you didn't tell them. Tell your neighbor, I refuse. You will not make me timid. Because you know me. I refuse. People at home, you got to be careful. Sometimes people at home can make you become so, it will smallize you. It's another word. Put it in your smallize. To make you small. The smallization of your own. They will reduce you, belittle, make what you carry, which is so amazing and great, they'll make it so little. And that can easily cause you to lose confidence in yourself. So the ego will end up walking like a chicken. But then when you go out, and then you see the appreciation, you understand? When people expose you, anointing expose you, your gift, and you see the way the people are eager and hungry, and listen, it's dreadful. So I came back from Germany, my confidence was boosted up. Amen. I came back from Germany, I'm determined now, the people from my home will not reduce me to nothing again. I refuse in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Don't let the people at home intimidate the best out of you. Come on now. They're quick to quote T.D. James. But they're living by your quotes. That's just bonus. Hallelujah. Amen. So God is good, amen. Let's open to the book of Acts. Acts. Somebody say act. It means that you should act. Amen. When you look at the book of Acts, it's all about action. Action. You don't see dead people, you know. It's war, action, activity. That's why sooner, you know, the way to, the Holy Spirit came upon him, that's it. Peter was hiding. Peter was shouting. Peter was, you know, holding back. Peter came out and said, listen, people, listen. Even the little girl who recognized me, yes, now I can tell you, I am a follower of Jesus Christ. Go and tell whoever you want to tell. Peter came out and preached powerfully. And 3,000 people were added to the church.
Oh, glory, hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Father, we pray this morning. We ask, O God, that your unction will permeate this place. And leave nobody untouched. May everyone under the sound of my voice be touched. Be influenced, O God, by your presence here. Heaviness, I pray in the name of Jesus, that it will be lifted Any heaviness in this place will be lifted in the name of Jesus. Any confusion will be confused in the name of Jesus. Any curse in this place is cursed in the name of Jesus. Father, let your people be free today. Hallelujah. Let eyes be open. Let ears be open to hear your voice. Let the meditation, Father, of my heart, the words of my mouth be acceptable in your sight, my Lord and my Redeemer. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. Acts chapter 1 first. Let's read chapter 1 verse 8. Acts chapter 1 verse 8. Seriously, I feel empowered from this morning. And that's why, listen, if you're a prophet, you've got to go ahead of the people. The prophet's word goes ahead. Amen. It goes ahead of the people. The prophet has a word that leads the people. Amen. Not behind the people. And when you see them moving, it's like, yeah, I knew you would move. When they rise, you know, I knew that you were going to rise. I knew that all along. No, you go ahead of the people. So this morning, I had to go ahead of my people and announce to them that they should come ready. Because I saw the service, and it was a marvelous, great service. To announce to them, watch today. Today is going to be a powerful service. Amen. Hallelujah. And I feel excited because God is about to do something amazing in someone's life. You just watch the next few minutes. God is about to do something spectacular in your life. Amen. The book of Acts chapter 1 verse 8. This is what it says. But ye shall receive power. Hallelujah. Ye shall receive power. After that, the Holy Ghost is come upon you. Amen. This power is different from the power that you receive to become a son or a child of God. The Greek makes a difference between the two. They both say power in the book of John chapter 1. You know, those who believe in him, you know, you give them power to become sons of God. That power is authority to become a child of God. Authority. It's an authority that is given to you. Amen. It's the right. It's giving you the right to become a son or a child of God. And your heir together with Christ. You have the right. That's one power, one kind of power that the Bible, the New Testament actually talks about. The second kind of power that the New Testament covers is dunamis. And this is the second kind of power is strength. Hallelujah. Is strength that is given to the individual. Strength. It's not just the authority. The authority you already have. Amen. You already have the authority to be called a son of God. But now, the Holy Spirit will come upon you and you receive power, strength. Amen. In the inner man. And the Bible says that, and you shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria and unto the uttermost part of the earth. That's Acts chapter 1, verse 8. Amen. Now, this is very significant that though the believer is born again and he has authority to identify himself as a child of God, he doesn't have power, strength, to operate as a child of God. Hallelujah. Until the Holy Spirit comes upon you. Hallelujah. You don't have that power. Amen. When Jesus sent the disciples out in the book of Luke chapter 10. Follow me carefully. When he sent them out in the book of Luke chapter 10. He paired them up. Right? That's early stage. The Holy Spirit hasn't come upon them yet. They went and did everything they did by the authority. Amen. It's authority that is given to them. And Jesus himself said that, I have the authority. And I've given you the authority. Amen. So they went in the authority given to them by Christ at that moment. Not any strength, hallelujah, that is given to them, but authority given to them. And when they went, the demons subjected and submitted to their authority that was given to them by Christ. Amen.
Like even during that time, there were certain things that they could not do. They tried to, at one point, heal this particular person, and it didn't work. So they came to Jesus and said, why? Why didn't the person receive the order that we gave? And Jesus said that that one can only be done but through prayer and fasting. Amen? Hallelujah. But then he already told the Jew in the book of Mark chapter 2 that the time will come for his disciples to fast. Hallelujah. They asked him, why are they not fasting? He said, the time will come for them to fast. Amen. That time will come. Then when they couldn't heal the child, he told them that it could only be done through prayer and fasting. And again, let me just show you again. Remember that when Jesus took them to the Mount of Transfiguration and asked them to pray, they couldn't pray for an hour.
Hallelujah.
These are disciples, you know. They could not pray for an hour. So he came back, he said, Can you guys wait for an hour? Can you not pray for just an hour?
Somebody say, the strength was not there.
Hallelujah. The strength was not there. Hallelujah. But it will be given to them. Amen. It will be given to them. The time will come when that strength will be given to them. So I'm just touching on this thing to lay a foundation. See the picture that I'm drawing here. Amen. So the born-again believer has authority to identify himself as the son, a son of God. Amen.
Because Adam was made like that, in the likeness of God. Amen. Male and female, one being, both male and female. Amen. So when it says son of God in that passage, it actually includes both the genders. Amen. So you are included, ladies. Amen. You're included.
Right. So you have the authority to be a child of God, a son of God, by virtue of your belief. You having faith. You believe in Christ. You believe. You accepted him. That's great. But you need another power.
Hallelujah.
You need another power. That power is given to you when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. That's why every single believer needs the Holy Spirit to come upon you. Just as every single believer could not have become a believer if they have not accepted Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. So Jesus said in the book of John chapter 3 that he that is born, what is born of spirit is spirit, and what is born of flesh is flesh. Amen. You're born of flesh through sin. When Adam fell, you became a child of sin.
Hallelujah.
You became a child of sin. That's why when you're born from your mother's womb, you are born into sin. You come with sin. You're a child of sin. A child of sin will look like sin, will talk like sin, will have the characteristic of sin. And you had that characteristic before you became born again. If you want to dispute it, let's rewind the tape to when you were little. I always do this, and I point to myself. I used to run into the kitchen and open the pot, the lid, and then grab the meat, sometimes hot, throw it into your mouth, and hold it there. And your mommy is coming back into the kitchen. She just popped out quickly. And by the time she comes back, the meat is in the mouth and it's tormented. The dog, but you don't know how. And then you're just praying and hoping that mommy won't ask you any question that requires an answer. And mommy did ask the question. Where did you put this or that? You have to answer. So you have to hustle yourself. You have to hustle and get out of that kitchen quickly. I need to use the kitchen. I need to use the toilet. And run. And sometimes you're caught actually opening the lid. Anybody was caught before? Were you caught? Sometimes in the middle of the action, the little boy, you took the chair, put it up there, climbed on the chair, and began to take some of you egg. You already had one, but you didn't have enough. So you're going into the kitchen for one more. Some of you chicken. Oh, Tola, where is Tola? Chicken. You see chicken, that's it, you're confused. You cannot gather yourself. And your mom, your parents, they know you very well. That you cannot gather yourself around chicken. They saw how you were disturbed when the chicken was done. And they believe, oh. And your mom acted as if she was sleeping. She just closed her eyes for a minute. And then opened it, she looked. And caught you. Anyway, listen. You were born into sin. Amen? You are a child of sin. And for that reason, you need to be born out of it. Hallelujah. You need to be born out of it. That's what rebirth is all about. That's why you got to be born again. To be born again means again. Amen? That means you were born before. Hallelujah. But you need to be born again. But this second time around, you're born not into sin. You're born into righteousness. Hallelujah. Amen. You're a child of righteousness from that moment onward. Hallelujah. So Jesus said that the one that's born of, whatever is born of flesh is flesh, whatever is born of spirit is spirit. When man was made, in the book of Genesis chapter 1, let's go there and look at it. The Holy Spirit is needed in every aspect of our lives. Because the Holy Spirit was needed at the beginning. For man to be man, for man to be active and alive, man needed the Holy Spirit. Without the Holy Spirit, man would not have been alive and active, empowered. Just like the fuel, without the fuel, the car would not move. Whether the fuel is now you have electric cars or whatever, the same thing applies. Amen. So listen to this. Man was made in the book of Genesis chapter 1, 26. Man was made after the likeness of God. And that likeness is spirit. Amen? Some of you heard this before, you hear me again. Hear me well. That likeness of God is spirit, because the Bible tells us that God is a spirit. And those who worship God must worship Him in spirit and in truth, not in flesh. Amen. Amen. In spirit and in truth. Amen. Yeah. That truth is righteousness. Amen. Not in spirit and sin. Not in spirit and flesh. But in spirit and in truth. Amen. And remember, the order is spirit first, then truth. So if you're not born of the spirit, you cannot speak the truth. Hallelujah. You don't have truth. You cannot live in truth unless you're born of the Spirit. This is very important that you understand. Genesis 1:26. Man was made in the likeness of God, or after the likeness of God, which is the accurate translation. After the likeness of God, or the image of God. Man was made spirit. Amen? So spirit, man, in Genesis 1:26, you were spirit man first. The spirit could not leave here just like that. Then he will be comparable to the devil and to his agents, because they're also spirits. Amen? But for the spirit to leave here, to have the right to live here, to move here, God formed the flesh for the spirit. Amen. Just like it was done for every animal. But animals don't have spirit per se. They just have a soul. Hallelujah. That's why we don't bury them the same way we bury human beings. Animals don't do that. Animals don't come together, organize a funeral for the grandmother or grandfather. So, man's spirit made Genesis 1:26. And then man's spirit was blessed in Genesis 1:28. You can be looking in your Bible as I'm saying this. Those of you who don't know, or having seen it like that before. So man's spirit made Genesis 1:26. Genesis 1:28, man's spirit was blessed. Amen. The flesh didn't know what was happening. The flesh was not there. Amen. Then Genesis 2:7, the flesh was formed. Remember that the flesh was formed, the flesh was not created. Amen. But the spirit was created, the flesh was formed. That's the accurate translation in the Bible. The flesh was formed by the hand of God. That's why the flesh has formed. Amen. So when we identify God as the potter and we are clay, we're talking about clay as in the body. Amen. Because the spirit is not clay. Amen. So when we say he's the potter, we're clay, we're talking about dust. We are dust. As in the flesh. But beside the flesh, we're not dust. Amen. So the flesh was formed by the hand of God, given a shape. You don't have a square or diagonal human being. Because God gave us the shape that we have. Amen. The head. Have you met any man with a square head before? God is amazing. Amen. He's amazing. It's not by chance. That when I look at you, I see myself in you. You look at me, you see a human being. Amen. When you look at a bat, you don't see yourself in a bat. Amen. So God made man's spirit. Man's spirit was blessed to have dominion on the earth. To rule over the earth. Amen. To have authority. Man's spirit, not flesh. When you reverse it, you don't have authority. Amen. When you reverse it, the flesh does not have authority. It is the spirit that has authority. It is the spirit that is blessed. Amen. So the one who is blessed by Christ, the one who is blessed in God, the one who is blessed in spirit is indeed blessed. Amen. When the Bible says, whom the Son set free is free indeed, it's talking about spiritual freedom. Amen. Amen. You're set free in Christ spiritually. Amen. So you are indeed free. You will prosper as your soul prospers. Amen. So, the flesh was formed. In Genesis 2:7. But then the flesh could not do anything by itself. And the spirit was in existence with blessings, but could not necessarily transfer those blessings into material. So, you know, it couldn't transfer it into the flesh. Hallelujah. So sometimes the blessing is shot in the spirit, but it's not, does not transcend the spirit. Hallelujah. The glory that Jesus carried transcends his body. That's why when he went to the Mount of Transfiguration, the glory came forth. Amen. It pierced through the flesh. It burst out of the flesh. His glory burst out of the flesh. The flesh could not contain it. Amen. So, the spirit was in existence. The flesh was not formed, but there was no connection between the two. The spirit looked at the flesh and said, who are you? The flesh look at the spirit and say, I don't know. The flesh knows nothing anyway. Then something happened. God, spirit, ruach, the breath of God, came into man. God breathed into man's nostrils, and when that breath was received on the inside of man, it brought life into man. Amen. Before he brought life, he connected the spirit that was in existence to the flesh that was formed. Amen. He connected the two. There was a connection between the two all of a sudden. Now the spirit is connected to the flesh. The flesh contained the spirit. The spirit now had life given to it. Sorry, the body had life given to it. And the five senses of man were activated from the breath of God. Without the breath of God, which is the Holy Spirit, the five senses would not have had any activation. They would not be active. Amen. Man would be just a corpse, just standing, just there on the floor. Not one move, won't do anything, won't be able to do anything. The eyes were closed. The ears shut. Hands couldn't move. Couldn't breathe. You put some something on the map, on the tongue, would not be able to taste it. But then Ruach came into man. When God breathed into man's nostrils, what happened? Activated the man. And the Bible said man became a living soul. Hallelujah. So the life was carried into man by Ruach, the breath of God. Amen. Then the eyes popped open, the ears popped open, then the senses were activated. Then man can touch things, then man can feel things, then man can hear, then man can smell. Amen. Then all of a sudden man can see, became aware. But before these five senses were activated, there was one sense that was active already. That's the spirit sense. Amen. Somebody says spirit sense. The spirit sense is the sense with which you connect with God. It's the side of you that received the blessing from God that was active before the five senses. Amen. So after the five senses are dead, gone, the spirit sense will still be alive. Hallelujah. Amen. Now listen. That's the foundation I'm laying. So now man became a living soul, powered by the spirit, Ruach, breath that came into man. Man became a living soul. Because of sin, we fell from grace. We fell from the glory, from where we are. We were with God. We fell from that place. Because we were not made robots. We were made in the likeness of God, and we have free will. Because of the love of God, we were given free will. And in exercising that free will, we chose sin. We chose to heed to the voice of the devil, the voice of the enemy. But that was not the end of man. God still made a way for man to return home through Jesus Christ. And that way was not made 2,000 years later, 6,000 years later. That way was made then and there. In Genesis 3, verse 15, God spoke prophetically and said, when he declared a curse upon man and the snake, he said there will be enmity between the two, the seed of the woman and that of the snake, the serpent. Amen. There will be enmity between the two. And he said that the seed of the woman will crush the serpent's head. But then the serpent, the snake, will bite, will bruise his heel. That's Genesis 3, 15. Already Jesus is already spoken of. You already heard about Jesus, the coming of a son. Amen. The seed of Abraham. So that seed will cross the serpent's head. The serpent will bruise his heel. What does that mean? Isaiah 51, Isaiah 53 tells us about it. It says that he will be bruised for our transgressions. Amen. So the bruising of his heel is basically him taking our sins upon himself and shedding his blood, amen, because of our transgression. And that's all the enemy is able to do to him. But then in return, he will crush the enemy's head, meaning he will overcome the enemy, amen. So through Christ, we have the victory over the enemy. Hallelujah. So moving forward, you are born again now. Well, after, you know, the fall, the people of old had to live by faith. And all those who lived by faith, who believed in God and obeyed his voice, it was reckoned upon them as righteousness. The Bible says it in the book of Hebrews, chapter 11, that Abraham believed God. Amen. He believed God, and it was reckoned upon him as righteousness. Amen. But then we today, the book of John chapter 3, let's open to it. This is good news for you. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. This is good news. Amen. Amen. Somebody say good news. Yes. This is good news for you. Don't let anybody manipulate you. Don't let anybody who is won over by fear manipulate you to believe that God does not exist, or to disbelieve in the existence of God. When you disbelieve in the existence of God, you will live on this earth, yes, but you will live by fear. This is the truth. Every atheist is very fearful. They're scared. It's their fear that motivates them to write fat books. And they talk plenty. Their fear that inspires them. The fear that
this is real, then we're in trouble.
So to disprove his existence will free him to live here anyhow. But that fear never leaves. No matter how many books they write, the fear is still there. And it torments them. So the atheists will wake up in the morning and say, what is this about this God? And the atheists will be vexed and angry when they hear about God. But we don't get angry, vexed, upset. We don't go home with, you know, anger in our heart because somebody did not believe in God. Because someone said they don't believe in God. You understand what I'm saying? Mm. We love you still. Amen. It's okay, you don't believe that. That's okay. You want some food? Give you some food. You hungry? You don't believe. That's okay. Still love you. You don't believe, you slap us, we say that's okay, we'll forgive you. Hey, the atheist won't forgive you. You slap the atheist. Don't forgive you. If they cannot physically do anything to you, they will morally, they will verbally do it. Or they will, in their hearts, you want to change my battery? Do that quickly. And the atheist now is smart because they use their brain a lot. And they're trying to flip it to say that we believe in God because of fear. Because we're fearful that if we don't leave a certain way, we'll be sent to hell. Now, the believer does not leave out of fear. The believer lives out of love. The believer does not leave. I haven't met a believer who is doing what they do because they're fearful that if they don't do it, they'll be sent to hell. No, the believer does it because they love God. It's out of love, and we want to be with him. Want to be, you know, want to go to heaven, not out of fear that, you know, if we could have been sent to hell. Hell is not even on my mind. I don't even think about hell. I don't know about you. Do you think about hell? I don't. I don't even think about it. It's not my concern. Anytime I think about hell, I want to share the good news with somebody. It doesn't shake me up like, oh, you know, let me make sure I pray now. Oh, if I go to hell. No, when I'm singing unto God, it's out of love. Amen. My heart is won over by love. It's a beautiful thing. Amen. And I see human beings as human beings. Amen. Not things. The atheists want you to see human beings as things. A bunch of atoms and things that chemical react, you know, things that have been put together chemically. You know what I'm saying? Like, why? Why should I see a human being like that? You're more than atoms. Amen. But anyway, good news. The good news is this. That through Jesus Christ, we're born again. We become believers. I'm good with time. Thank God. Hallelujah. John chapter 3. That's why I came up here early. As I'm speaking like this, things are happening spiritually. You can't see, but it's happening. As I'm talking like this, angels are moving. Some of you have headache. The angels are rubbing your head. Yeah, some of you have some issues, some problem, stomach problem, issue, little things here and there. You don't know how many people have been healed without knowing that they were healed. You do not know how many people were set free without knowing they were set free. That's why every day we must give thanks to God. Because the things he does, the invisible things he does in our life, mind-blowing. People have gone to bed and they did not wake up. Hallelujah. Sometimes before the doctor could detect that cancer, could detect that problem, could detect that thing, God has taken care of it. Hallelujah. And he doesn't even tell you. That's why some of us, you know, we're very ungrateful. Not acknowledging him. Not waking up every day and thanking. Hallelujah. Good news. John chapter 3. Let's read. There was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. The same came to Jesus by night and said unto him, Rabbi, we know that thou art a teacher from God. For no man can do these miracles that thou dost except God be with him. He came to command Jesus, but Jesus knew better. Jesus was not there to receive commendation. He was not there to receive applause. He was not there to be approved by man. He was there to save your soul. And that should be your concern, Nicodemus. Were you here so that we can now have, a praise party because Jesus is doing so many marvelous things? And if for some of you, you will have taken that praise. You will have received that praise. You said, Nicodemus, say to continue talking. So nobody can do these things if God was not with him. Carry on. You are a man of God. Keep on going. In fact, you are an apostle. Keep on. We want to be praised. But Jesus did not receive the praise. He was concerned for the soul of the praiser. Amen. The one who came to, applaud him and praise him and say this all these things about him. He was concerned about the state of his soul. Amen. Some of you will carry friends along. Will take your friend with you so that they can be clapping for you. And they are not saved. You take them with you so that they can praise you. They can, say good things about you. Say all the... You're not concerned about their misery. They're sad. They're broken. They have issues. You're not concerned about that. As long as you come with me and praise me. As long as you come with me and, celebrate me. I'm okay. You're a bad friend. Very bad. You should be concerned about their condition, their lives. You should be concerned about where they are in life. Amen. Hallelujah. Show some concern. Hallelujah. Jesus did that. How did he do it? Look at this. Nicodemus said, if God is not with that, with you, you will not be able to do these things. Verse 3, Jesus answered and said unto him, verily, verily, I said unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Nicodemus said unto him, how can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter the second time into his mother's womb and be born? Jesus answered, verily, verily, I said unto thee, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. Amen. Verse 6, that which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Amen. Marvel not that I said unto thee, you must be born again. You must be born again. You got to be born again. If you're not born again, the Holy Spirit cannot come upon you for you to have strength. And that strength will enable you to fulfill your purpose and your destiny. Hallelujah. You will not be able to fulfill your purpose and your destiny here unless you're born again. This is the truth. Beyonce is not fulfilling her purpose and her destiny. Don't let them lie. They shouldn't lie to you. Michael Jackson did not fulfill his purpose and destiny. Michael Jackson was suffering when people were dancing, when people were celebrating him. He was suffering. He was crying and calling people to help him. But we were entertained by him. Michael Jackson would go home and struggle to sleep. He needed to sleep with drugs. He had to inject himself, medication, all kinds of things for him to rest his head. But then the world was entertained by him. Whitney Houston was struggling. And the whole world was entertained by him. Oh, you got a beautiful voice. You got an amazing voice. Oh, all these things. But Whitney was crying for help. A lot of these celebrities. I remember once, not long ago, Lil Wayne came on social media and put out, people, I need prayer. Say, pray for me. I remember when Chris Brown also put it out, that people pray for me. Remember people, some of you here, put on Twitter, Lil Wayne, we all of that. People of God. Amen. When you're born again, that's the only time that you begin to experience the peace of God. Amen. But then God, the Spirit of God, needs to come upon you just like the Spirit of God was needed to activate the members of the body. Amen. The same way, when you're born again, you need the Spirit of God to come upon you to activate the power that is within you. Amen. To give you power so you can do exploits. So you can carry your goal, sorry, your purpose. You can fulfill it here. Otherwise, you will not be able to fulfill it. It requires strength in the inner man. Because devils will come against you. All kinds of things will come against you. Your own people will come against you. You go through a lot, so you need strength. The Bible said David encouraged himself in the Lord. Because he needed to be encouraged. Amen. In the Lord. Hallelujah. And Jesus said in the book of John chapter 6, 63, that the flesh profiteth nothing. The words that I speak, they're spirit and they're life. Amen. It is the spirit that quickens. That's Jesus speaking. He said, it is the spirit that quickens. The flesh profits nothing. The words I speak, they're spirit and they're life. Amen. So you need a quickening spirit. Even though you're born again, you still need a quickening spirit. Amen. And when that quickening spirit comes upon you, then you'll be able to achieve your purpose. And you keep going. You will fall, but you pick yourself up. The Bible said the righteous man will fall 7 times, but you will pick himself up. You will rise again. Amen. Amen. You will fall while you're on the journey to fulfilling your purpose. You will be pushed down by men. You will be forgotten. You will be sabotaged. All kinds of things will happen to you. Shipwreck. All kinds of things will happen to you. Robbed. You will have all kinds of experiences, but you pick yourself up as you have the Holy Ghost with you. Amen. The Holy Spirit gives you power to keep on keeping on. So we all need the Holy Spirit. And I will highlight just one point for my topic to the world. One, by the grace of God, not two. One. Now I think I should do two. And then we'll close. Listen. God is good. Amen. Amen. Verse 6. That which is born of the flesh is flesh. And that which is born of the spirit is spirit. Marvel not that I said unto thee, you must be born again. You got to be. Verse 8. He said, the wind bloweth where he listeth. So the wind bloweth wherever he wants to. And thou hearest the sound. You hear the sound of the wind. But you don't know, but canst not tell whence it cometh. You don't know where it comes from. You hear the sound of the wind. It blows wherever he wants to go. Amen. You hear the sound of it, but you don't know where it comes from. Amen. You don't know. And it says, and whither it goeth. You don't know where it comes from, and you don't know where it is going. But you hear the sound of the wind. Hallelujah. Jesus said this shockingly. Some of you have read this in your Bible. He said, so is everyone that is born of the Spirit. Wow. Jesus likened the one who is born of the Spirit to the wind. I've been reading this for years. For years I've been reading this. And it always shocked me. Like, what does it mean? What does it mean that everyone who is born of the Spirit is like the wind? Because the wind blows, you hear the sound of the wind. The wind blows wherever he wants to blow, has a direction. The wind blows, we don't know where it comes from. And we also don't know where it is going. And he says, so is every single person born of the Spirit. So, before I went to Germany, I was searching the scriptures. I was praying and waiting on God. I have loads, by the grace of God, I have tons of sermons. Because I spent quite a while, a long time when I was in church, just serving, I was writing sermons. And I'll read them to myself. And I'll say amen to my own sermon. Yeah, for years, for a long time, I say amen to my own sermon. I was empowered by my own sermon. for a long time. So that's why I teach in series. If you're used to me, you know that I teach in series. When I take one topic, we'll look at it for 6 months, and we'll keep going. You know, and as we're going, God speaks even more. And I also learned not to hold revelation, not to keep revelation. When we started in church, I was scared that if I keep sharing this revelation, I'll end up not having any more. And I'll be inspired. When these people come, what will I say? And I have to keep going over the same revelation, and the people will see through it and they'll be like, Pastor, sorry, you know. Yeah, we've been hearing this for a while, you know, Pastor. We want something fresh and new. Even the manna was, you know, fresh every day. So, Pastor, you know, what's going on with this manna? I was scared at first. I came, you know, and I was sharing revelation because I didn't preach with notes. To those who have been around, Boniface, and a few who have been around, tell you, I didn't preach, you know, I just come and say, hey, listen. Hey, God is saying. and I think that, oh, I'm like, yo, listen, these revelations will finish. I need to be careful. But then I had, God set me free. And God showed me how, if you give more, more will be given to you. Amen. If you're trying to hold back, then look, guess what, you'll lose it. God doesn't work with people like that who are stingy. Leprosy. It's a curse. God doesn't work with people like that. People who are give. Amen. God pours in you, pour it out. Let people be blessed. I learned that I was free. And from then, I'll come every time. I'll pour out. Revelation. Every week, revelation. We don't have conferences. We have weekly services. Yeah, that's what we have. We don't have conferences. Happily we have conferences because we have weekly services that are as powerful or more powerful than conferences. So we're fine. Amen. We don't need to bring an American preacher to come and wow us with their tell your neighbor. Watch this. We've been watching this. We've been watching this. Amen. So listen, so I come every week. I've been doing it for how long? 6 weeks? 6 months? 6 years? Every week I'm here. And God has kept me healthy.
Amen.
Amen. Now listen, so you be like that. Amen. Be generous. Amen. When God bless you in knowledge, understanding, wisdom, share it. Guess what? You pour more. The more you share, the more he'll give you. Amen. Don't try to hold into it like it's mine. It's my revelation. No, it's not yours. Amen. Any gift given is for someone. Amen. There's no gift that is given for you to give. Hey, often your gift is not yours. Your handsomeness is not, it's for a young lady. Hey! It's not for yourself to be looking in the mirror like, yo, I'm really handsome. I mean, like, this guy, nobody can. It's for somebody to admire it, enjoy it. My wife, is that right? Amen. We thank God for everything. Amen. Amen. Now listen. God is good. God is good.
All the time.
God is good.
All the time.
So God, Jesus, is likening, he's likening you to the wind. That's profound. So everyone who's born of the Spirit is like the wind. You hear the sound. You don't know where it's from. You don't know where it's going. So is everyone who's born of the Spirit. So I began to seek God. I said, God, what does it mean? I've been reading for years, but I never heard anything preach on it before, but I can't find anything preach on this. Speak to me. Then God started speaking to me. And that's what I said when I went to Germany. I just said one of a few points. I didn't even go deep, but it was a blessing. So one of the retreats, when we went for the retreat, I gave them a pre-insight into this. So the people who went to the retreat, they're already
amen.
Listen, now the wind, you're likened to the wind, and that's powerful. So I began to look at the wind, and God started talking to me about the wind. The first characteristic that you find about the wind is that the wind is subject to God's voice. Number one, characteristic of the wind. The wind is subject to God's voice. Amen. The wind obeys the voice of God. Hallelujah. Somebody will think, will say, you know what, how about, you know, the tornado and all these things that destroy lives and destroy, listen, you have the elements, the four elements, earth, water, fire, and wind, right? Amen. They're subject to God. And if these elements were to be used by the enemy in any shape or form, whichever way is used, God has to allow it. If God does not allow it, it will not happen. This is the truth. And someone will say, but what kind of wicked God will allow that? You have disallowed God to intervene in your life.
That's
right. So you become the master of your life. Stop the tornado.
Wow.
The one who has it, you has him. Do you understand what I'm saying, people?
Yes.
The one who hush the storm, hush the wind, you hush him. So hush your own storm. The Bible tells us in the book of Romans chapter 1 that God gave them up to reprobate mind. Amen. He gave them up. He said, well, you keep going back and forth with God. No, you don't exist. No, you're not real. No. I don't want to. No, I want to do my own thing. Okay. And every good father would do that at one point with their children. Don't tell me God is wicked. Let's watch your life. You become a mother, become a father. And let's see how you react when your son keeps saying, telling you to F whatever. When your son keeps telling you to whatever. Your son keep, you will not lose, you will still love them. But at one point you say, okay, no problem.
That's it. It's true.
Okay. Son, I'll be praying for you. But you have your life. Go ahead. You disallowed your mom. You disallowed your father. Now you have your own life. Go and live it. Some of us will die that. And we've seen what happened to us. And God showed us in the Bible about the prodigal son. Amen. He went, but he came back to his senses and returned home. Amen. So some of us can return home the same way. But now listen. God is the master. He is the voice that the wind was subject to, would submit to. If God does not allow it, it will not. All the four elements, it's very prophetic what Jesus did when he was here. Remember, he did a few things. First of all, Jesus showed you that he's the master of the four elements. He showed you that. He walked on water.
Come on now.
Water carried him. Because he is the master. Amen. He hushed the storm. He is the master. The storm recognized the voice of his master.
Amen.
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 Hallelujah. When he died, he went to hell and set even captive free. The Bible says, even there. Amen. Why? Because even hell fire is not fire for Christ. So prophetically, when you look in the book of Daniel, he was the fourth person that stood next to Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego. Fire became cool. Because fire saw his master. Hallelujah. What's the fourth one? Earth. Hallelujah. He went into the ground and the ground vomited him out. Hallelujah. The crown could not hold him. The Bible said that. Listen. Death could not hold him. Amen. The crown could not hold him. He has to vomit him out. Because he's the master. So the four elements that you should dread. Jesus. And mastered his four elements.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Now listen. And he said that you are like the wind. First characteristic, the wind, the born again believer is subject to God's voice. Jesus said, my sheep hear my voice, and a stranger, they don't follow. Amen. So the first characteristic of the wind, the one who is born again, you are like the wind. Amen. You are, you know, it's not a characteristic, but I want to break it down for you. You are a living mystery. The wind is a living mystery. Amen. The wind is a mystery and it's living. You feel the wind right now, don't you? You feel it, right? Do you know where it's from? No. Do you know where it's going? No. And if the wind was to blow even harder, you would hear the sound. Hallelujah. You can't see it. Does that mean it doesn't exist? It's actually more real than anything. Hallelujah. It's so real, the wind. You are a living ministry, a mystery. When you become born again, you be a living mystery. And your first characteristic is that you obey the voice of God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
That's the first characteristic of the wind. And the second one, which I will close with. I will close with this and I have more.
Amen.
Amen. So in the weeks to come, come. Listen and you'll be blessed. And as I'm doing this, God is working on you. Amen. God is working on people. Some of you have been walking in disobedience. But this is grace that is extended towards you. You've been here to hear this message. It's grace extended towards you. Hallelujah. To bring you back to that place of total obedience to God's voice. Amen. To hear God's voice and obey Him. To walk in the ordinance of God. The second characteristic of the wind is that the wind is flexible. Flexibility, adaptability.
Oh, Lord Jesus.
Just like you supposed to be. The born-again believer, the born-again Christian, you are like the wind. You are adaptable and flexible. You can live anywhere and everywhere. You cannot be contained and programmed and controlled and manipulated. You're flexible. You can turn here and there. You are flexible, adaptable. You can move to China and survive in China. You can be locked in the prison and you'll be all right. You can be put in the desert. You will be all right. God will feed you there. Amen. We are flexible. Flexibility and adaptability is a quality that you have as a born-again believer.
Hallelujah.
What is the condition that you're put in? You adapt. What is the condition? The wind can adapt to any condition. The wind is flexible. Amen. The wind can be, make a little room. The wind will be all right there. Big room, the wind will be all right. Amen. Open the roof, the wind is okay. In the heat, it's okay. In cold weather, it's okay. We are adaptable. We're flexible. Amen. Hallelujah. We do not shrink. We do not faint. We don't grow weary because the conditions have changed. We don't crack because the conditions have changed. Friends are with you. Okay, okay. They're not with you. Okay. You like me? Okay. You don't like me? Okay.
That's it.
You don't want to come with me? Okay. You don't want to come? Okay. Amen. Flexible. We are one. Okay. We are many. Okay. Yes or no? Okay. Amen. The wind is flexible. Some of you, because somebody said no, that's it. Your life has come to an end. Because they said no. Somebody said no, that's it. That's all. They said no. That's it. That's the end of you. Hey! Rise up!
Amen!
Amen. Rise up! You are adaptable. You are flexible. money, that's okay. Amen. You don't have money, it's okay. God is good, amen. God is good, amen. God is amazing, amen. Listen, we don't have much, but we still celebrate. We still give him the praise, amen. But we don't have much. What is wrong with us believers nowadays? You need to begin to identify yourself as the wind. Because Christ said you are like that. So is everyone who is born of the Spirit. You're like the wind. You're adaptable. You obey the voice of God. Amen. You're flexible. The people don't understand. When listen, don't worry about it. Amen. Just obey the voice of God. Hallelujah. Flexibility. Some of us, we want to know our purpose before God can put you in one particular, a path or career. He will have taken you through so many.
That's right.
Yes. Mm. You want to be a sweet, nice cake for your husband. Hey, you will have been oil. You will have been, name all the things that, make up the cake. Well, how do you make cake? Bake it, tell me.
Flour.
Eggs.
Flour.
Sugar. Butter. Wow. Amen. You will have been all these things. And when we put you together, then you will taste sweet. Some of you don't want to be all these things. You just want to be oil. Hey, why? Why? You just want to be one thing. Why? Say, oh, let me be the egg. Hey, listen, the egg will not make up the cake. Hallelujah, by itself. We need to mix it with all these other ingredients. Amen. So some of you got to open up. Amen. Tell your neighbor, say, open up. You're too stiff. You're too stiff. You come to church like this. Open up. Free yourself. The wind is very free in here. The wind is the freest person in this place. Thing in this place.
That's right.
Very free. Can go under the chair. the wind can blend in so well. Amen. Very flexible. It can be there and you don't even know it's there. Very flexible. In quietness, very cool. Loud, not very cool. What is it? Put me there. I'll be all right.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. Some of you want to know your purpose? God will take you through. He will take you through different things. And you got to be flexible in God's hand. Just like the clay is flexible in the potter's hand. The shape God wants to give you, he should give you.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. If God wants your hair on the left side, let him do it. Amen. Hallelujah.
Amen.
If you want to take your hair off, it's okay. Let him take it off. Amen.
Amen.
Somebody say, Amen. Some of you can never take your nails off. Your nails are ahead of you. You can't. Flexibility, amen. Just growing up in Christ, I learned that. I learned I have to be flexible in my dressing. I cannot be rigid. That I only wear jeans. And I only like, listen, be flexible. Amen. Because there are places that you win some souls there. You can't wear jeans and go there. Amen. They say come with trousers. Don't say that me, I just like jeans. Oh. So Paul said to the heathen, I was like a heathen. Amen. Say to all men, I was all things. I became all things to all men so that I may. Somebody say flexibility.
Flexibility.
Say, I became all men. All things to all men. Amen. That I may win them. That's flexibility. Amen. Paul went everywhere. Arabia, where did he not go? Did he not go? Please, we didn't speak the language. Some of you want to send you somewhere where you don't speak the language. Say, oh, Pastor, why would you send me there? Why don't you send Lola there? So Lola speaks you, but Lola speaks Islamic. Send her there, she will be able to survive. Hey, listen, it's okay. You'll be fine as long as you have Christ in you.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. You'll be fine. Go there and flow. Amen.
Amen.
That's why we have a flexible church.
Yes.
Amen. We don't have a rigid church when, culturally speaking, very rigid. When you come here, we do things like Ghanaian, we do things like Nigerian, we do things like these people, we do things. I don't like those things. Amen. I want Jamaican to be comfortable here. I want the Angolan to be very comfortable. Amen. And the Portuguese to come here and be very, very comfortable. Feel like you are home. Feel like you are your brothers and sisters. And that's how it is like here. We have different people from different places. When we start mentioning where people come from, Malawi, Uganda, different places, it's amazing. Amen. Amen. The Caribbean, St. Kitts, we have St. Vincent, we have different places like Jamaica, we have Congo, we have Belgium, we have France, oh Lord Jesus, we have, the Arab nations, we have Pakistan. Isn't it amazing? Amen. Yes. Flexible, then we can do a lot. Amen. Amen. God can use us in different areas. Some of you, you said, you're called to be a singer. And then we say, okay, just do the welcoming for a bit. And then you're upset. Like, you're supposed to be leading the worship. You're not supposed to be doing the welcome. Oh, Lord Jesus. You don't understand that one day will serve you. When you stand in your office, it will serve you. Amen. It will become handy. It will come handy. It will become like useful to you. All the things that God puts you through. All the seasons. Amen. Look at life. Look at the year. We don't have just one season. We have different seasons. And we have to survive through the seasons. So the believer has to be prepared that way. Amen. The believer is flexible. In different seasons, you're still a believer. Amen. The seasons may change, but your belief remains the same. Amen. Hallelujah. Flexibility, adaptability, and I think I should end there. Hallelujah. You are flexible and adaptable because you are born again. I believe that God has begun that work in your life today, and I know that God will fulfill it. He will accomplish it. He will finish that work. Amen. Some of you did not know this before. You didn't understand that side of you, so you were rigid when you were asked to do this, do that. You are rigid. You are very, very rigid and restricted in yourself. You're not open. We can't tell you to sit down. You like standing, so we can't tell you to sit down. You like doing things a certain way. We can't, change. You're not flexible. God cannot use you. Anybody who is not flexible, God cannot use you. Amen. When you see yourself as a seed, and you're in God's hand, what happened to the seed to start with? If God was to do anything with the seed, what does he do? Plant it. Right? So if you're a seed in God's hand, for God to use that seed, what does he have to do? Throw it. Some of you don't want to be thrown. What do you want God to do? The sower, we're seed in God's hand. You don't want to be thrown. You're too special. Angels have to carry you gently. You've got to be thrown. And you will scream, God, that hurt. It's okay. And the ground has to open. And you'll be buried.
That's right.
Amen.
Amen.
You've got to be flexible. Some of you, you don't like crying in front of people. Welcome.
Amen.
Welcome. Welcome to a place where people who never cried in their lives. You shall cry. Tell them, say, you shall cry. By all means. Some people, you are their friend for a long time and you never seen their tears before. Hey! What happened to your tears? You don't cry. Joshua, you cry. I've seen Joshua cry before.
No way.
What do you mean, no way? He's not flexible. Listen, that's why women are easily used by the Holy Spirit. Listen, I have a lot to say. I have to close. Women are easily used by the Holy Spirit. Men are very stiff. Hey, I'm praying for you. Relax. understand? You pray for men. A man is like this. I'm falling there. This ain't happening. Listen, some of you men, when the Holy Spirit is moving, your face even chases him away. Your facial expression just pushes him away. Hey, stay away from me. Women in general are very flexible. Look at your mother and look at your father, then you understand what I'm saying. Your father is very one way. Your mom, she's able to do this, to do that, to try this, to try that. She can open up to this, can open. You know what I'm saying? The father said, let's go to China. I said, okay. The mom said, okay, let's go. But let the mom come and say, let's go to China. What? The father will be like, what? Where is that coming from? I'm not Chinese. Do I look like Chinese? But the woman will move. We do things, we try different things. Women are very open. Mostly, amen. 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 This is the truth. They're very open. That's why they look after our children better than we look after them. Amen. That's the truth. That's what they do better. Because they're open. Man, very rigid. And society has manipulated us as well. You have to be a man. Man don't cry, you know what I mean? No matter what, man, don't cry. Be open that you may cry. What's wrong with that? What's wrong? The women, they will shed tears, they will fall, they will do whatever, they will be broken, they will, you know, some of you doing too much. But because I'm teaching on flexibility, don't take it to another level. Don't take it to another level, amen. But listen, in God, we have this, you know, when you're born again, and some of you are born again, and you're very, listen, it's difficult to work with you. It's just difficult. It doesn't help you. The Holy Spirit cannot work with you. I'm telling you, the Holy Spirit will not, you will not be used greatly. You won't go far if you're not flexible. Don't be rigid. You know, you're somebody that you do things a certain way. So what? And then you come and you expect us to do things the way you do it. You expect us to talk the way you talk. You know, I mean, you expect us to, look, it doesn't work like that. If you're like that, you won't even have many friends.
True. That's right.
It's the truth. If you're like that, you will not have many friends. You'll be so, you know, isolated. You know, you'll be your own friend. And you'll be lying that you're happy like that, you're fine like that. You're not fine like that. Please, do not lie to yourself. There is nobody who doesn't need friends. There's no one. Hallelujah. Even Adam, when he was laid alone, God said that it's not good for Adam to be alone. Amen. So he made somebody to be with him. He could not have a companion in dogs. And you have people in this society today, their companions are cats and dogs. Yeah. And they say they're happy. My dog is my best friend. Yeah. So be flexible, amen. Amen. Open up. Allow it. Understand that you come from a Caribbean background, so you don't use to certain things. I understand you come from an African background, you don't use to certain things. I understand that you were so posh. You know, you come from that, you know, these chairs are too cheap. You don't sit in the chairs like this. I understand, but can you be flexible? You are born again Christian.
Oh,
right. Amen. Amen. You're born again. Mm. Can you just allow it? Mm. Amen. Amen. It's not your cup of tea. I understand. Some of you say that, you know, this is not my type of church. It's fine. Mm. But for all you know, this is what God wants for you.
That's right.
For all you know, this is what God wants for you. It's uncomfortable. It's too, you know, in your face. You know, it's not like Joel Austin, you know, just standing in one place. Just raise your voice to the Lord and say, God, you are my everything. And today I am blessed.
Everything is working for my good. Amen. You are blessed. Have a wonderful day. And you're so happy. I understand. That's one way. Amen. That's one way. But don't be rigid that, you know, this is how I like it that way, so it should be that way. No, be open. Amen. Because you may move to another country. They don't do things like that. Then you cease from being a Christian. Then you cannot congregate. Then you cannot fellowship. Because they don't do things that way. Because in that city, you cannot find a pastor like Joel Austin. Then you're dead. And you stay home and watch TV. You stay home and be watching TV. It doesn't work like that. Amen. And a lot of time we come to God and we come to Stephen. We come so God will break you first. Amen. For him to mold you, for him to shape you up, he has to break you. Amen. And if you don't allow it, then you will never be built. You have to allow God to break you. Amen. Be flexible. Allow him to. Amen. Let's stand and pray.